Good morning. This topic covers financial accounting under statement of financial position. Under the new curriculum provided by the Commission on Higher Education, this topic of statement of financial position is part of the conceptual framework and accounting standards. Under the CPA board examination, this is under financial accounting and reporting. We will discuss the theoretical aspects of a statement of financial position. This statement is one of the components of financial statements and formerly known as the balance sheet. In the old principles of accounting, this is balance sheet, and today under the new standard, it is called statement of financial position. Let's proceed. So, the statement of financial position, formerly called the balance sheet, is the report showing the assets, liabilities, and equity of a business enterprise at a specific date. This statement provides information about the nature and amounts of investments in enterprise resources, obligations to creditors, and equity in net resources. So this is the basic definition of the statement of financial position. Let me explain them in details. The report presents the assets. Assets means the properties owned by the business registered under its name. So when we say assets, it is either current assets and non-current assets. I will explain in detail what do we mean by current assets and non-current assets. The essence of presenting assets in the statement of financial position is that the reader may have an idea on how much is the total resources being used in the business of an entity. By just looking at the total assets of an entity, you may have an idea of the actual size of the business. It is expressed in Philippine peso. Next, the statement of financial position also presents liabilities. In the layman's point of view, liabilities are the indebtedness of the company. Because in business, whenever you enter into a business, you cannot avoid incurring liabilities. Every now and then, you may borrow from somebody to finance your business. In some instances, your supplier may offer credit terms, and that is your opportunity to grab that offer. It is an opportunity on the part of the business. So we cannot avoid incurring liabilities. Liabilities are considered legal obligation, meaning we have to pay this indebtedness in due time. The reason why it is presented in the statement of financial position or balance sheet is that for the readers to have an idea how much is the indebtedness as against the total assets. Because presenting the total assets alone may be misleading. You may have millions of assets in your business, but if that millions of assets will be compared to the millions of liabilities, your assets may become wasted. That is the essence of presenting liabilities in our statement of financial position. Next, the statement of financial position also presents the total equity. Again, in the layman's point of view, equity represents the capital of the owners. It represents the investment of the owners in the business. The reason why we have to present equity is that we want to show if the capital of the owners are growing or not. If you are the owner of an entity, if you put up a business and you are one of the owners, what is your expectation? Whenever equity is presented to you, you want to show growth. You want to show increase in your investment, because that is the reason why you invested in a business venture. You want to grow your capital. So, if you are reading a statement of financial position and equity was presented, your expectation is that you want to see growth in your investment. Your statement of financial position must have that specific date. The statement of financial position is just like a newspaper. It is presenting some news about the company. Try to read a newspaper. The date is always there because we want to know when it happens. Any statement of financial position or any financial statements has their own cut-off date. Usually, the date of any financial statements is at the end of the year, at the end of the quarter, at the end of the semester, and in some instances, you can see financial statements at the end of the month or monthly financial statements. The date is a significant part of the statement of financial position so that you can know when these events happen. So the statement provides information about the nature and amount of investments. If you put investments in other companies, those amounts will likewise be presented in your statement of financial position. Those will become part of your assets. The reader of the statement of financial position would have an idea how you put your money in some investment instruments. So that is the simplest definition and the simplest explanation of the balance sheet or the statement of financial position. The statement of financial position provides vital information in financial statement analysis. We need to analyze the statement of financial position. The reason why there is an analysis of this financial statement is that we want to do some evaluation. We want to do some analysis on how the resources and the indebtedness and the capital are being managed by the company. And that is the essence of having this statement of financial position. We need some information for our own evaluation, for our own analysis. Some of those needed information are the following. Number one is the current ratio. Current ratio is one of the financial ratios that being used in order to evaluate the liquidity position of the company. Liquidity position means the capability of the company to settle maturing obligations. Current ratio is one of the common financial ratios. These are being used not only by management but also by some lending institutions if you try to borrow money from them. So that is the current ratio. Next, we have the return on assets. The return on assets measures how your assets are being used to generate revenues. This measures how your assets are being utilized to attain the objectives of your organization. Number three, we have the return on equity. The return on equity is presented in the form of percentage. It shows how many percent you earned in your investment in a certain company. By this means, you can measure the efficiency and effectiveness of the amounts that you invested. It will show how much or how many percentage did you earn from that investment. Next, we have the capital adequacy ratio. This is mostly applicable to banking institutions but is now being used by some companies. The purpose of capital adequacy ratio is to measure the adequacy of the capital as compared to the risk assets of the company. The risk assets are being compared to the capital. What do you mean by risk assets? Basically, risk assets are the receivables and investments. Why are they called risk assets? Receivables are risk assets because you may be exposed to risk in case of non-payment by the creditors. So, investments are also considered risk assets because if your investment suffer losses, your company will also suffer from losses. And there is a certain percentage. The total capital must be enough to cover risk assets. And that is the purpose of capital adequacy ratio. So let's discuss the usefulness of this information contained in the statement of financial position. So I prepared here the table showing the financial ratio, the formula, and the meaning of the results of this financial ratio. The purpose of this presentation is for us to appreciate the significance of the information that we need to analyze in the statement of financial position. So let's take up current ratio. So the formula for current ratio is current assets divided by current liabilities. Current assets means those assets which are convertible to cash within the current year. In the same manner, current liabilities are those indebtedness which must be settled within the current year. So whatever is the total current assets, you will divide that amount to the total current liabilities. So what is the significance of this formula? So the significance or the meaning of this formula is that it measures the capability of the company to pay maturing current obligations. In other words, it is simply measures your capacity to pay indebtedness which are supposed to be paid within the current year. Example, if your total current assets is 1 million and your total current liabilities is 500,000, you will divide 1 million by 500,000. The result is 2. If we will convert that to ratio, the result is 2:1. What do you mean? Or what? How can you interpret the ratio of 2:1? That means 1 represents your current obligation, your current indebtedness, while 2 represents your current assets. That means for every 1 peso liability, your company has the capability to pay 2 pesos. That means your company is capable enough to settle maturing obligations because the liability is only 1 peso, but you have 2 pesos to settle any maturing liability. So you have an excess of 1 peso. You have that capability to settle maturing current obligations. So that is the meaning of the current ratio. Next, return on assets. The formula of return on assets is net income divided by total assets. What is the essence? You will get the net income. When you say net income, that is the net income after deducting income tax. So you will divide to net income divided by total assets. So what is the purpose? The purpose or the meaning of that ratio is that determines how assets are utilized to generate revenues. So the result of this ratio is in the form of percentage. Example, the return on assets is 30%. That is the result of the total net income divided by total assets. The result is 30%. That means 30% of your total assets are being utilized to generate revenues. 30% of your total assets are being utilized to achieve the objectives of your organization. There is no hard and fast rule what is the ideal percentage on the return on assets. It may depend on the industry data. So as of now, I cannot say that 30% is good in the eyes of the investors and the owners of the company. Some may say that 30% is not enough. Some may say that 10% is good enough. It depends on the appetite of management, and it also depends on the industry data. Next. So the next financial ratio is the return on equity. The formula is net income divided by total shareholders' equity at the beginning of the period. It is very simple. Just get the total shareholders' equity and then get the net income. Divide net income with the total shareholders' equity, and the result determines the percentage of return on the investment of the owner's equity. We have different interpretations as far as return on equity is concerned. Some call it return on investment. Some call it return on equity. So whatever is the label, it determines the percentage of return on the investment of the owners of the entity. Example, after dividing the net income with the total shareholders equity, the result is 10%. How can you say that 10% is delightful in the eyes of the investors? How can you say that 10% is good enough to convince outside investors to join your company? How can you say that 10% is good enough? How can you say that it is satisfactory enough? In my own interpretation, the 10% must first be compared with the inflation rate. Today, the inflation rate in the Philippines, the last updated inflation rate is 2%. I don't know if that is accurate as of this date. But let's take an example. The inflation rate is 2%. And your return on equity is 10%. Since your return on equity is higher than the inflation rate, that 10% is good enough to satisfy the readers of the financial statements that your return on equity is delightful. Another thing to consider, the return on equity should be compared with the latest interest rate on treasury bonds. Just an example, supposing the interest rate on treasury bond is 4%. If your return on equity is 10% as compared to the 4% interest rate on treasury bonds, we may conclude that our return on equity is good enough, because if I am an investor and I can see that your return on equity is 10% as compared to the treasury bonds interest rate of 4%, I would rather put my money in this company earning 10% per year. So that is how I interpret return on equity. It is in the form of percentage. Again, you have to compare the results with the inflation rate and the interest rate on treasury bonds. Next, capital adequacy ratio. What is the formula? The formula is the total unimpaired capital divided by total risk assets. Supposing your total unimpaired capital is 500,000 and your total risk assets is 100,000 pesos. What is the result? The result is 50%. Is that good enough in the eyes of the readers of the financial statements or this statement of financial position? What is the purpose of capital adequacy ratio? That ratio determines if the total capital of an entity is adequate or sufficient enough to cover risk assets. What is the ideal percentage? The banks are using 10% as threshold as far as capital adequacy ratio is concerned. Meaning, if your capital adequacy ratio is not less than 10% or at least 10%, your capital adequacy ratio is good enough. in the eyes of the financial analyst. Why 10%? Because in the banking industry, the average allowance for doubtful accounts or the average allowance for impairment losses is 10%. That is why they created the threshold of 10% to determine if your capital adequacy ratio is good enough. So in our example, if the total unimpaired capital is 500,000 and the total risk assets is 1 million, the result is 50%, and that is good enough because that is above the threshold of 10%. The next question is, what do you mean by total unimpaired capital? Total unimpaired capital is the total capital less any appropriation. Appropriation like appropriation for plant expansion, appropriation for dividend declaration, appropriation for software acquisition, and other means of appropriation. What do you mean by total risk assets? We are referring to the total receivables, and we are also referring to the total investment or financial assets. They are considered risk assets. When it comes to receivable, there is a risk of non-collection. When it comes to investment, there is a risk of losses. So that is how we compute and interpret capital adequacy ratio. So let's discuss the contents or how are the items being presented in the statement of financial position. As a minimum, the statement of financial position shall include line items that present the following amounts. The first item is our property, plant, and equipment. Everybody knows what do you mean by this account title. They represents land, building, machineries, equipment, furnitures and fixtures, and other plant assets. They are non-current assets. And also we have our investment property. If we acquire property for purposes of investment and we earned income out of that property, that is classified as investment property. Intangible assets represents copyrights, trademarks, patents, and other intangibles which are also presented in the statement of financial position. And then we have the financial assets, excluding amounts under letter E, H, and I. Financial assets are investments to other companies. Example, our company decided in the shares of stocks of San Miguel Corporation, that is a financial assets. Our company decided to invest in the corporate bonds of PLDT, that is a financial assets. Next, we have investment accounted for using the equity method. The equity method was discussed in another accounting subject. If you invested in the shares of stocks in another company and you are using the equity method, that means if the company where you invested your money gave you a share in the net income, that will be added in your investment account. If that company where you put your money as investment declared dividends, the dividends that you receive will be deducted from your investment amount. So that is what we meant by equity method. Next, we have the biological assets. Biological assets are being maintained by those companies engaged in agricultural business. Examples of biological assets are assets that produce fruits. examples, you planted trees and plants, and that plants and trees produce products which will be sold to the market. Your trees and plants are considered biological assets. You are raising cattle like cows, pigs, chickens. Those are biological assets, and they produce fruits that will be sold in your business. Next, inventories. If you are involved in the merchandising business or in a manufacturing business, the unsold goods and items in your position, in your possession, are called inventories. And you have trade and other receivables. If you sold your merchandise on accounts, those are receivables. And of course, the most popular asset is the cash and cash equivalents. That means your investment or your cash or your money deposited in a bank, and that includes cash on hand, and that includes time deposits with a term of 90 days and below. Next, non-current assets held for sale and discontinued operations. In some instances, you have in your possession equipment and machines, and you have the intention to sell it. Those are classified as non-current assets held for sale. In some instances, you have the assets in your possession which came from discontinued operations, meaning you stopped operations of a certain plant or factory, and the assets of this factory are still in your possession. These are held for sale. You have the intention to sell them. That is classified under these non-current assets held for sale. Next, we will also present payables, trade and other payables. If you are engaged in merchandising business or manufacturing business, usually you are purchasing goods on account. Those are considered trades and other payables. And then you have provisions. You have allowance for doubtful accounts. You have accumulated depreciation, allowance for impairment losses. All of them are classified as provisions. Provisions are considered contra asset account. And then we have financial liabilities, excluding amounts shown under K and L. So trade and other payables are not included, and also provisions. What do you mean by financial liabilities? For example, you borrowed money from the bank. You have to pay the bank, and that is considered financial liability. You issue bonds to investors. Your bonds payable is considered financial liabilities. So we have here liabilities and assets for current tax as defined in Philippine Accounting Standards number 12. PAS number 12 deals on income tax. So these are the tax liabilities. In some instances, we have deferred tax asset. These are also presented in your statement of financial position, and that letter N, liabilities and assets for current tax, refers to the current, not only income tax, for other taxes, pertains to the current year. Under letter O, we have the deferred tax liabilities and deferred tax assets, also defined in Philippine Accounting Standards number 12. Deferred tax liabilities, meaning to say we postponed the payment of our tax. We deferred it on a later date. Deferred tax assets most of the time represents excess payment of taxes, and we expect reimbursement from the Bureau of Internal Revenue. We expect refund, and that is deferred tax assets. And then we have liabilities included in disposal groups classified as held for sale in accordance with PFRS number 5. So these liabilities included in disposal groups are those liabilities which should be settled immediately. Non-controlling interest presented with equity. Supposing you are a majority shareholder in one corporation. Your company owns 90% of the shares of stocks of another company. Your non-controlling interest is 10%. That non-controlling interest should also be presented in your statement of financial position. And then, issued capital and reserves attributable to owners of the parent. So, if you are a subsidiary and the issued capital owns by the mother company should be clearly presented in your statement of financial position. So here is my explanation on the presentation of assets in the statement of financial position. The general rule is that assets are classified into current and non-current, the purpose of which is for financial statement analysis and for the determination of the liquidity position. If you will take a look in most balance sheet or statement of financial position, assets are classified into current and non-current because this is very essential. The current ratio that we discussed a while ago, in that ratio you can see the significance of this classification. You can easily measure the liquidity position by means of this specific classification. But there are some companies choose not to make this classification. In such a case, assets and liabilities should be presented broadly in order of their liquidity. This is the exception to the rule. The general rule is that most corporations classified assets into current and non-current. But there are some companies who presented assets as a whole, not classified into current and non-current. But according to the accounting standards, these assets, although not classified as current and non-current, should be presented in order of liquidity, meaning to say the most liquid asset should first appear in your statement of financial position. What are the most liquid assets? They are cash, accounts receivable, financial assets, inventories, and other liquid assets. And then non-current assets like property and equipment will follow. So this is the exception to the rule. Most readers of financial statements opted to review a statement of financial position wherein assets and liabilities are classified into current and non-current. This is for faster financial statement analysis. Such classification is very useful. When you borrow money from the bank, one of the requirements of the bank is for you to submit audited financial statements or in-house financial statements. The reason why they are requiring you to submit financial statements is that they want to measure your capability to pay. And if your balance sheets or statement of financial position present classified assets, the financial statement analysis and the credit review would be much faster. So what do you mean by current assets? Current assets, these are the assets which are convertible to cash within the year or in the period of 1 year. Meaning, that asset is easily collectible. or easily to be sold to other persons. It is easy to convert the cash, and that is within the period of 1 year. And these are the examples of current assets: cash. So cash is your money, either cash on hand or deposited in a bank. Accounts receivable, your receivable from your customers, especially if your business is a merchandising business, you sold merchandise on account. Next, notes receivable, your customers issued a promissory note and the term is 1 year or less, that is considered current asset. Prepaid insurance represents the insurance premium that you paid in an insurance policy. That means it is an asset, it is a current asset because you expect something from the insurance company in case there is an untoward incident. Marketable securities are those securities which can be sold or which can be easily sold in the market. Inventories are the unsold merchandise in your possession. So these are the examples of current assets. Non-current assets, these are the assets which are not possibly be converted to cash within the current year or for a period of 1 year. Meaning to say, non-current assets are not easily be sold. It is not easily be collected. Example, you have notes receivable. I forgot to include long-term notes receivable in our example. Your customer issued promissory note for a period of 1 year. That notes receivable is a non-current asset because it will take you more than 1 year to collect. So these are the other examples of non-current assets. We have the property, plant, and equipment. We are referring to land, building owned by the company, also includes machineries, equipment, furniture, and fixtures. It will take you more than 1 year to convert these assets into cash. We have also financial assets, the maturity of which is more than 1 year. Example, you put your money in the shares of stocks of San Miguel Corporation, and that shares of stocks is not saleable to the market. It will take you more than 1 year to dispose that investment. That is a non-current asset. Another example, you put your money in retail treasury bonds issued by the government, and the term of that bond is 5 years. That is considered non-current assets because it will take you 5 years to recover the proceeds of your investment. Another example, intangible assets, patent, copyright, trademarks. It will take you more than 1 year to eliminate that asset. And then we have deferred tax assets. As I define deferred tax assets, most of the time, or basically, there was an excess payment. Either there was a change in the tax rate, or there was an error in the computation. There was an excess remittance or payment to the Bureau of Internal Revenue, and the difference is classified as deferred tax asset. It is a non-current asset because there is no assurance as to when the BIR will do the refund of your excess payment. Next. So how will you present current liabilities in the statement of financial position? Generally, liabilities are presented in the statement of financial position as current and non-current, just like your assets. Liabilities are also classified into two, current and non-current. Current liabilities are those liabilities which can be settled within 1 year. And non-current liabilities are those liabilities which cannot be settled in a one-year period. It will take you more than 1 year. So current liabilities are legal obligations which are to be settled within the current year or for a period of 1 year. Example, accounts payable, which means you promise your supplier that you will pay them on 3 months, that is considered current liabilities. Non-current liabilities are those indebtedness which are to be settled for more than 1 year, otherwise known as long-term liabilities. Example, you borrowed money from the bank and it will take you more than 1 year to pay them because the term is more than 1 year, that is considered non-current liabilities. So the two are segregated for financial statement analysis purposes, just like your assets. They are segregated so that the financial analyst would do a fast financial statement analysis. So let's have some examples of current liabilities. Accounts payable, as I have said, if you purchase something from your supplier and you are supposed to pay in the future but not more than 1 year, that is accounts payable. And then notes payable, if the maturity is within 1 year. You borrowed money from a bank or a lending institution but the term is less than 1 year or 1 year, that is current liabilities. Number 3, salaries payable. Your employees rendered overtime and the overtime pay will be made the following month. Since the payment will be made within the current period, those salaries payable are considered current liabilities. Other expenses payable, you receive billing from electricity for the water utility company, and the expenses will be paid the following month. Those are other expenses payable to be paid still within the current year. Withholding tax payable, the amount of taxes you deducted from the salaries of your employees, that should be paid within the following month, and that is considered current liabilities. So we have to remember these points as far as classification of current liabilities are concerned. The first one, we must be careful for these pointers. We have to remember this by heart. Some current liabilities, such as trade payables and some accruals for employee and other operating costs, are part of the working capital used in the entity's normal operating cycle. An entity classifies such operating items as current liabilities if they are due to be settled more than 12 months after the reporting period. This is in accordance with the accounting standard. Let me explain. What do you mean by working capital? So, the working capital is the specific fund allocated for the day-to-day operations of the business. When you say day-to-day operations, that is within the normal operating cycle of your business operations. So, if that liabilities form part of your working capital and used in the entity's normal operating cycle, your company must classify those current liabilities, as current liabilities, even though it will mature for more than 12 months. So this is the point that we want you to remember. Firstly, working capital The meaning of working capital is that is the specific funds that you use in the day-to-day operations of the business, and that is within the normal operating cycle of your business. Supposing you borrowed money from the bank, and that money that you borrowed from the bank will be used as working capital. But the term of the loan from the bank is more than 12 months. Even if the term is more than 12 months, that liability should be classified as current liability because it is used as working capital. That is the point that I want to raise in this standard, or that is the point that this standard wants to point to everybody. Again, I will repeat my example. You borrowed money from the bank. The term of the loan is more than 12 months. Generally speaking, that loan is classified as non-current liability. That is the general rule. But if that money that you borrowed from the bank will be used as part of your working capital within the normal operating cycle of your business, that liability should be classified as current liability. So, that is the first point to remember. Next, second point. If an entity expects and has discretion to refinance or roll over an obligation for at least 12 months after the reporting period under an existing loan facility, it classifies the obligation as non-current even if it would otherwise be due within a shorter period. So, let me explain the meaning of this statement. In some instances, when you borrow money from the bank and you are a good customer, the bank gave you a discretion. What is that discretion? If you want to roll over your loan, or if you want to refinance your loan, you can do so at your own discretion. What do you mean by refinance or roll over? Supposing you borrowed money from the bank for 1 million and you decided to roll over the loan. You borrowed 1 million. Today is April 25, 2020. The loan will mature on December 24, 2020, meaning the loan is less than 1 year. But at your own discretion, because you are given the discretion by the bank, at your own discretion, you decided to roll over, meaning you will extend the maturity date. You will extend, instead of December 24, 2020, you may roll over the loan for another 1 year, or December 24, 2021, because the bank gave you the discretion. You will roll over the loan. The original term of the loan is less than 1 year, because today is April 25, the loan will mature on December 24, 2020, but you decided to extend the maturity, that is roll over. The original is less than 1 year, and it will be classified as non-current because of that discretion to roll over, even if it would otherwise be due within a shorter period. Once you roll over the loan, even if the maturity date is on a shorter period, the moment you avail of your discretion to roll over, the loan or the liability will be classified as non-current liability. So that is the second point to remember. Another point to remember, however, when refinancing or rolling over the obligation is not at the discretion of the entity. Take note, not at the discretion of the entity, meaning there is no arrangement for refinancing. Take a look and try to compare this statement with the previous one. There is no arrangement, meaning you are not given the discretion to refinance or roll over. The entity does not consider the potential to refinance the obligation and classifies the obligation as current. So this statement refers to current obligation, the first one, non-current. So, meaning there is no discretion. The bank did not give you the discretion to roll over. In other words, there is no arrangement for refinancing. In that case, the obligation will be classified as current obligation. That is in accordance with the accounting standard. Next, when an entity breach a provision for a long-term loan arrangement on or before the end of the reporting period, with the effect that the liability becomes payable on demand, it classifies the liability as current, even if the lender agreed after the reporting period and before the authorization of the financial statement for issue not to demand for payment as a consequence of the breach. Let me explain. What do you mean by breach of long-term loan arrangement? Breach means you violated the contract. There is a violation. What is that violation? Example, you borrowed money from the bank. The term is more than 1 year. The maturity date is today, April 25, 2020. You failed to pay the bank today. Today is the supposed to be settlement of the loan, but you did not pay. There is a breach. You violated the loan agreement. You violated the long-term loan arrangement. Once you violated the loan agreement, even if the loan is more than 1 year, the loan becomes payable on demand. It will become a current liability. Even if the lender agreed that you will pay for a longer period, even if the lender agreed that there is no immediate demand for payment, remember that. Even if the lender, we are referring to the bank, even if the bank agreed that you are not supposed to do immediate payment, the liability should be considered as current liability. Next, however, the entity classifies the liability as non-current if the lender agreed by the end of the reporting period to provide a period of grace ending at least 12 months after the reporting period within which the entity can rectify the breach and during which the lender cannot demand immediate payment. So the liability is non-current. You failed to pay the non-current liability. The lender agreed by the end of the reporting period there will be a period of grace. What do you mean by period of grace or grace period? Even if you fail to pay, you will be given an allowance of 12 months after the reporting period. Reporting period is the date of your financial statements. If you are given a grace period, your liability will be classified as non-current. What is the difference of this statement to the previous one? In the previous one, there is no grace period. So, in the first statement, the liability is considered current because the payable is should be paid on demand. In the second statement, if the lender gave you a grace period, the liability will be classified as non-current. So, this topic was taken from the book written by Maria Elenita Balatbat Cabrera and Reynaldo Rayo Ocampo entitled Financial Accounting and Reporting Standards and Applications, Volume 3. The explanations in italics are provided by me as the lecturer. So we will discuss the continuation of this topic in our next lecture. So I want to thank the viewers for patronizing this video, and I hope you learned something about how statement of financial position is being presented. And this lecture was based on the accounting standards existing not only in the Philippines but throughout the world. The reason why this requirement is being imposed is to have some uniformity, because one of the users of financial statements are government regulators like the Bureau of Internal Revenue, the Securities and Exchange Commission, the Banco Central ng Pilipinas, the Insurance Commission, and other regulatory agencies. So they want uniformity. And I hope you learned something from the standard that I enumerated in this lecture. Thank you and good morning.